computer.
Yeah, I started.
And anybody else? Let's have two backups. It's more reliable. Barack, or who was before? Please respond with voice. We are running out of time. Okay, we. Anybody else? To make backup recording, can you volunteer? Okay. Barack, do you hear us? Low record. Okay, I will allow for Katya as well, and hopefully some of them will do it. Okay. So we are starting the last lecture. I will share my screen, share my slides, make it here, and decrease it a little bit. I need to manage a little bit with my Windows. Okay. Now you see, hopefully you see. Okay. Please respond with voice to see that everything is okay. Ron?
Yeah. I can see the your screen.
Huh?
We can see your screen.
Okay, very good. So today is the second part of conic programming, second lecture, and the last lecture of our semester. It is rather loaded with interesting material, not only related to optimization, but general knowledge in matrices and matrix functions. So I hope it will be important for you also in other areas of your activity. Okay, and we will be without quiz today because is a lot of material. And the first topic is converting many interesting problems into semi-definite programming. And one of the main instruments to do this is the lemma of Schur complement. And I remind you, it says that if I have a block matrix, symmetric block matrix, here blocks P, Q transpose, Q, R, where P and R are symmetric because they are diagonal, and Q is a general rectangular. Also, we assume that matrix R is positive definite, then all this matrix is positive definite if and only if we take matrix P minus Q. If you follow my mouse, it would be good. P minus Q transpose R inverse Q. You see, it's written here, is positive definite. And the same for semi-definite. And our first class exercise to get you familiar with this very important lemma is to prove it yourself. And here is the general guidance for the proof which we had in the lecture. And it was if a matrix is positive definite, that any vector, any quadratic form, if for example some matrix W is positive definite, then for any non-zero vector X transpose WX should be positive definite. The only thing, our matrix is with blocks, so instead of X we use U and V. We split to the blocks which correspond to the blocks of the matrix. And how I multiply, for example, block matrix to the block vector, it's the same as I would have numbers. It's P multiplied by U plus Q transpose multiplied by V will give me first upper element, upper vector in result, and again Q multiplied by U plus R by V will give me second. Okay, so I write this quadratic form, and I say that it should be non-negative for every such a vector. Then if I minimize in V, it also should be, this product should be also be non-negative or positive. And this is my way to solve. This is quadratic function where V is variable and U is constant. So you write it as a function of V, multiplying matrices by the rules I told you. And write down its gradient, equate it to zero, and get condition which should be the minimum should give you this expression. And after having this expression, we say that if for every U this expression is non-negative, then the matrix itself should be positive, definite, or positive semi-definite. Okay, you can start working. Or any questions, any comments on this part?
No questions here.
Okay, so just start work. You have questions? I didn't get it.
I just wanted to give you feedback.
So. Ah, okay, thank you very much. Okay, you can start working and even response with voice when you are ready. And I will put a recording on pause. And please remind me. A second. Pause recording. Okay. I resumed my recording. So if Ron can repeat briefly what you already did. Or I repeat yes. It for you. I repeat it for you. So you
okay.
You took this quadratic form and you just opened it with block matrices and block vectors, which is written here. You wrote it's like inner product of two vectors. Or it's actually transpose vector multiplied by vector row multiplied by vector column, and you continue with this and you get this expression, and we want to minimize it with respect to vector V. So you write down gradient with respect to V. Okay. Ron, of course you can do it via differentials. This is one way to do. But we also already know the gradients of quadratic and linear expressions. Yes. What you have here, for example, the last term is quadratic with respect to V. Yes.
Yes.
And the two other terms are linear. So with linear terms, gradient is just what is multiplying the vector V. Only in right form, it should be column, yes? It should be column. So it should be not U transpose Q transpose, but transpose of this. It should be QU. Or QU.
QU, okay.
Okay. What other term will tell us? Another QU, yes, it's the same actually, yes?
It's the same.
Okay. And what the last term will give us?
It's twice RV.
Excellent, excellent.
And now we equate it to zero.
Okay. And what is U as a result? So we say that R is what is V? Yes, R is
yes.
R is invertible.
Okay, So
no half. You have two and two.
No, you're right. R minus one, a q u.
Okay, and then what we should do? We should substitute to our function f of v.
Just a second, maybe a minus sign.
Yes, you're right. Hopefully that we didn't do any mistake. I really rely on other students that follow us. And please, anybody who is following, just raise your voice. It's okay. Okay. So and
the
then
it is okay.
And then we substitute this v to the expression of f effort of v. Yes.
Yes. Okay. Sorry for the background. I'm unmuting myself.
Mm-hmm. But you can comment on yourself. It's nice.
Okay. So.
Okay.
Yes. I am substituting in the expression for f. This is the third term, and now the last term here is v transpose. There will be two minus signs, so I just cancel both of them. And I put r minus 1 q u, r and r minus 1 q u. And essentially, to find the infimum over this function with respect to v.
You know, Ron, we should save time a bit, not to write all explanation, but go with formula and then you will write explanation. Nicely. Okay. So, what do we have? Did anybody do calculations of this? Okay.
I think
some terms cancel. Yes?
Yeah. Let's see.
You have a lot of expression where you have something like U transpose, some matrix, and then U. Yes? You should just summarize all those matrices, and U transpose and U will take outside. Let's put, so we have P,
yes,
minus Q transpose. You see, we have actually those two terms which we have in the theorem, and hopefully other terms will cancel somehow.
Michael, may I ask a question, just a second?
Yes.
In the term for F, we have U transpose inside, we have U transpose Q transpose V, and we have V transpose Q U. It's the same, not because it's scalars.
You mean they can cancel, yes?
They're not cancel, but you can add it, I mean.
Yes. This is exactly what I say. If you take U transpose and U outside, in other words, if you take U transpose like Ron is doing, then all matrices may be summarized. But it should be canceled somehow, yes?
Yes.
Okay.
R is symmetric.
So and we get this nice. So Katya was right. It was other way to motivate what we are doing. So all those are scalars and we can sum them up. Okay, so we get the same expression. I don't know whether, I am not sure that you see my whiteboard, but we have the same expression as we have in the lemma. So we, in order for any u this to be non-negative, the matrix inside should be positive semi-definite. And this is exactly what lemma claims. Okay, Ron, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
You can stop your sharing.
Thank you, thank you.
So, and actually, so we got this claim, yes? We finally got this claim. And so I have some other preparation stuff, technical mathematical stuff, and then we will move to so the second thing is rather trivial, but it's useful to remember it. So if I have so this is different stuff, and then we will use all this stuff in our future examples. If I have a matrix A which has eigenvalue decomposition with matrix diagonal matrix lambda, what will happen if I add some scalar multiplied by identity matrix? What will be eigenvalues of this expression? Does anybody know?
They will be shifted by t.
It's lambda. I can write it in different ways. One lambda is diagonal. I can write it in this way. Or if I have some concrete eigenvalue lambda I, so instead of this, it will be lambda I by t. It's a rather simple thing, but it's very useful to prove it. And this is our second very short exercise. And you can start working. So I just give you a brief motivation. If A V is lambda V, some particular eigenvalue V, then think what will be A plus. It's very trivial, yes, but you want to summarize it. Okay, it's really for 3 minutes, not more. And if anybody is ready, please let me know. And I hope that you see my whiteboard in full screen. And I hope also that the recording is working in this way. I remove participant list.
We should see that we should find the eigenvalues.
Yeah, yes. If you know eigenvalues of matrix A, the question is what are eigenvalues of matrix A plus some number scalar t multiplied by identity matrix. Identity is matrix of ones on diagonal.
Okay.
So, and if anybody finish, please let us know.
I can share.
Okay, who was first?
Katya. Ladies first.
Okay. Katya, you have very good gentlemen in our class.
No.
Just go ahead. It's very small things. It's nice to go ahead. Are you ready to share?
Just a second.
For Katya, it takes half a minute to take picture and show him.
No, it's I took just in. Do you see it?
Yes.
I wrote it very shortly.
Okay.
Like there, so maybe.
Can you use your pointer?
Yeah, of course.
Okay.
So we need to prove that if lambda is the diagonal matrix corresponding to A, yes, with the eigenvalues.
Yes.
So lambda plus TI is the diagonal matrix corresponding to A plus TI.
Mm-hmm. Lambda plus TI is eigenvalue matrix of A plus TI. Okay, yes.
Yeah. So the proof is that given some eigenvalue of A, lambda I, and the corresponding eigenvector VI, such that A multiplied by the eigenvector VI is lambda I VI, we know that by applying the matrix A plus IT on VI, we obtain AVI plus, this is identity, so it doesn't affect, so it's T plus TVI, and we know that this is lambda IVI plus TVI. So this is the corresponding eigenvalue, lambda I plus T, and maybe it's important to say that those are the only eigenvalues.
Yes, and the, this is exactly, thank you very much. The eigenvectors stay unchanged, yes? So eigenvalues are shifted and eigenvectors are the same, like in the original matrix.
Yeah.
Okay, yes. Thank you very much. You can stop your sharing. And what will be next? Wow, I have one more linear algebra preparatory question to have everything together, and then we will move to optimization. Okay, I should remove something. Let me remove here. So my next question is this. I will remind you what was in the lecture, the notion of operator norm. What is the operator norm of some matrix A? Is maximal of AX. Maximum of AX over axis with norm, two norm smaller than one. Okay? And our challenge is to show that norm A squared, if I take square of this number, it will be lambda maximum of A transpose A. It's very important fact, and many of you could know it before, and it was used in the lectures, as you remember. Okay, I hope that you are with me, and I hope that I'm recording. Am I recording?
Yes, yes.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, and how can we approach this? I just give you a hint and you will continue yourself. That what is the norm of AX? One, two square. It is AX transpose multiplied by AX. I immediately instead of X, AX transpose, I write X transpose A transpose, yes? And even without prime, multiplied by AX. And now what can I do?
Michael, but this is not operator norm, what you are doing now. This is the original norm, the L2 norm.
No, just second. I consider this expression norm, L2 norm. Pay attention. Thank you for very good questions.
Okay.
Pay attention that here I have definition of operator norm of A and how I defined it via two norm of vector AX. What is will be maximal two norm of vector AX if vector X has limited two norm less or equal one?
So Michael, I think we should denote it differently here, because here you write A2 as the operator norm. Here you
Yes, you are right, but this is the mathematical convention. If I take a matrix and I write 2 here, the meaning is operator norm. And if I have a vector, pay attention, this is a vector, yes?
Okay.
And write 2 norm, this is usual 2 norm. This is mathematical convention. Okay, and this is also usual 2 norm. So I want to open this. And this I can open in the way I told you. And of course I can do eigenvalue decomposition of this matrix. So this is some V, just I'm thinking where to put transpose. So usually we put transpose on the right. V lambda, V transpose, I think in this way. A V V lambda, yes. And then I just give you line of proof and then you will finish yourself. And then of course I have here as it was X transpose here and X here. And I can denote this as some vector Y transpose. And there is a very interesting fact when this matrix is symmetric, the eigen matrix of eigenvectors is orthonormal, orthogonal and normalized, and it doesn't change the norm. You can take it as a given that multiplying by orthogonal matrix preserves the norm. So if norm of X was less than one, then also norm of Y. So I denote this as Y. And I invite you continue along those lines and discover that this expression, so I instead of have maximum over y of y transpose lambda y, and that maximum of this expression is just lambda max. So I gave you a general framework and you can try to organize it yourself and to prove the final things. Here I have ordered eigenvalues from lambda. You can think that the largest is the first and then decreasing order. And then what will happen with this expression? Okay, just start working. All those three facts were used in the lecture, it's good to have them clear in your head. I will try to pause. Alt P.
You're welcome.
Okay. Okay.
I didn't hear what you asked.
If anybody ready, please raise your hand. Okay, Barak, yes, please. Would you like to present?
Okay. You see my board?
Yes.
I did some preparations as much as I could. Okay, so our problem was originally this was the problem.
Yes.
And we denoted the Y transpose, and maximizes over this is maximizes over this, and we can also look at minimizing the minus.
Ah, okay. Okay.
It's not so much.
Okay. Less. Okay.
Just go, for the sign.
Go ahead. This.
And do we have this
constraint? Yes.
Yeah, constraint that we have to keep. So we build the Lagrangian.
Yes.
We did the goal function, and this is
Lagrange
multiplier, yes, Lagrange.
Yes.
This is, yes. And we take the gradient, and we okay. Just let me do here a square. Okay, the norm square here.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, it doesn't matter.
Okay.
I take it for convenience. So here we have also the square. And now I take the gradient of the Lagrangian, and equals to zero.
Mm-hmm.
And we get of the two, and we get that lambda y equals mu y, which means that y is a eigen vector with mu as eigen value.
Okay. Just a second. You get lambda y equal to mu y. Lambda is diagonal matrix, yes?
Yes.
Okay.
That's what I developed. But,
so you didn't maybe get the final.
No. I did the plugin, but we can see from there. Now we plug what we know that to the goal function. We have max y over y that supplies this. So we have y transpose, and instead of lambda y we can write mu y, right?
Okay.
Which is still max y. Of mu norm of y squared, and then we have such that we still have the constraint. Okay, I just plug in what we found.
I have only question: Did you do the development? You just copy it, or you just do it online now?
I'm copied. I'm copied from my.
Next time it's easier for you, I guess, just to make a picture, to make a photo.
Next year, when I repeat this course, I'll do it.
So
now we have this problem,
mm-hmm.
And if we have this constraint, we mm-hmm. would take we can take a y. With that is norm is one, okay.
Yes.
With this we'll maximize this, and we will take mu as the maximal eigen.
So mu should satisfy this equality. Yes, mu y is equal to lambda y.
Yes.
And you say it satisfies only when mu is low, not more than maximal eigenvalue. Okay.
It can't be.
So you can say this is one way to solve it. Yes. And you conclude that mu is maximal possible eigenvalue. Yes.
I will take him to be maximal because I want this to be maximal. So
yes.
If it's negative, I may take him to be minimal.
Okay. So I think honestly I need to think about your solution. It's interesting. The only problem it has that you minimize non-convex function, but still it may be valid. Okay, thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Okay, just don't forget the trend mark.
Okay. Yes.
Okay. Don't forget. Yeah. It's sunny today, so put him at.
Nice.
Thank you.
Thank you, Barak. You can finish your sharing. Any other version of solution?
I have a different kind of way to solve this.
Okay. Or maybe I will do it briefly because we have a lot of stuff to do. Let me try on my whiteboard. By the way, we have here we used very important fact. We told that norm of V transpose X is the same as norm X if V is a orthonormal matrix. Yes.
Yes.
Are you with me? I want for completeness just to show this fact in one line. So norm V transpose X, for example, 2 squared, is X transpose V. Do you see? X transpose V, V transpose X. Yes, the vector multiplied by transpose itself. But because V is orthogonal matrix, its transpose is its inverse. So the product of V V transpose is identity. And it's equal to X squared. It's for you to have complete picture what we used here. And now I'm not sure that I will have enough room here. But what is written here, what is Y transpose lambda Y? One can easily pay attention that lambda is diagonal matrix. So to multiply lambda by Y, it's just element wise product of lambda I, Y I. What we have here, it's some lambda I, Y I squared. Okay? Are you with me?
Yes, Michael, yes. Yeah.
Okay. And we say that we have a sum of Y I squared equal to 1, yes? Norm of Y equal to 1. When we maximize this expression, one can show to maximize this expression, you should use Y is, for example, such a
Michael, are you recording? I'm not sure just because.
Thank you very much. I think I am.
No, I just see my recording.
I am. When you see a list of participants, you see who is recording, and I also. Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, good.
Okay. So I say that vector y with 1 and all other zeros maximize this expression if, for example, lambda 1 is the maximal one. If I order it lambda as lambda 1 is the maximal one, because if you have here sum of from 1 to n, I from 1 to n, if you choose y as I wrote, you get the all this expression is just lambda max, yes, lambda max, and the same as lambda 1. And if somebody else chooses y to not to have here one, but we need to have y squared maybe. If you take vector of y squared in the way that it sums with one, one can easily show that this sum will be smaller than I am just hand waving, but giving you the basic idea, another idea of proof. You don't have enough time, but along those lines, I hope you can easily accomplish the proof. Okay.
Michael, I just think it's important to say that knowing this y, we can recover the x with the v. Because the maximum is over x, so we say there indeed exists such x that recovers it.
Yes, yes, of course, because y is
v transpose x.
V transpose x, or x, if v is orthogonal, x is vy, and of course, yes, thank you very much. And we can also have this optimal x, which gives optimality. Okay, very good. Now we can continue. And what is my plan for today? So we proceed with slides for the problem of minimizing maximal eigenvalue. Okay, let me start screen share again. Okay, share the screen and maximize. Okay, and you see my face. Okay. So the first problem we considered in the lecture, you have a matrix which linearly depends on vector x, yes, which is written here. Sum xi by some matrices ai minus maybe constant matrix b. And this sum we briefly expresses some operator a calligraphic x. A calligraphic maps as usual from vectors to matrices. And we are considering the problem, find such a x that maximal eigenvalue of A of x will be as small as possible. And we say that minimize maximal eigenvalue, minimize any function of x is as minimize some artificial variable t under a condition that this t is larger than this function of x which we want to minimize. We already had this trick in other part in minimax problem in conic programming. Okay, this is very important trick. If you have any questions or if it is clear, just let me know. Or I should remind you the picture maybe on the whiteboard. Let me remind you the picture. So I say that if I have a function of x and I have minimum, it's the same like introduce another artificial variable t and say and this is the we call epigraph, yes, epf. And Carlos, I don't remember exactly the notation in the lecture. Say epigraph of my function. And I want to find minimal t minimize t such that T belongs to this epigraph, to this set, yes? And this is exactly my solution. Epi of F. Or what is written here, I will take better pen, it's T greater or equal F of X. And this is, and I minimize, of course, in T and in X. So it's a very known trick and it's very important. So you meet it already second time. So what we have here, I have a function lambda max of X, yes? And I say instead of minimizing my lambda max, I minimize some T under constraint, the T greater or equal lambda max. So if it's clear, say clear. If it's not clear, please discuss. It's important.
I think we need to let it lechalchel.
What is lechalchel? Anybody can translate?
Yeah, percolate.
Calculate? Okay.
Percolate. I think that he said we need to let the information percolate.
Okay.
Or understanding.
Okay. So maybe we will do it at some point. Okay. But saying that T greater than maximal eigenvalue, I would say that T is greater than each of them. Yes. I order, for example, here is the list. So or T minus each of them should be greater than zero. Say this, I say that like you already learned, eigenvalues of this matrix T minus A should be greater than zero. Yes, because eigenvalues of minus A will be minus lambdas, yes? And then I add TI, and you already proved that adding TI, I just add the T to every eigenvalue. So to say that T is larger than every eigenvalue, it's the same as say that eigenvalues of this matrix should be non-negative. Or in other way, to say that matrix TI minus A should be positive semi-definite, which is written here. Okay, any question? This is new stuff and you should get used to it. Unfortunately, because neural networks, we don't have homework on semi-definite programming. I am still thinking that we have many courses of deep learning now. Maybe my course should return back to pure optimization. Then we will have more time to elaborate, not with you, but with next students. No, if anybody is able to ask question, it will help us.
So is the original problem to find the minimum over the largest eigenvalue for A of X?
Yes, so to find such X, yes?
Yes.
That if you take x and compute a of x and you have lambda maximum of a, this is our function, yes?
Yes.
And then we ask for which x this lambda maximum will be minimal.
And instead of solving this problem, which is difficult, to find an expression of lambda in as a function of a of x, it's difficult. We trade this problem for an equivalent on the left, minimize over t, so that t is larger than the largest eigenvalue a of x, and this is in fact how do we say semi-definite.
We show that it comes to semi-definite programming. It comes to this formulation. And this is already semi-definite programming. Why this is semi-definite programming? Because we have a matrix. All this expression is a matrix, which linearly depends on my x and on my t. I have extended vector of variables, t and x. And all this is linear expression, linear matrix expression of those variables. So I have in general, I am in general framework of semi-definite programming to minimize some linear function. This is very special linear function of extended vector, t and x, yes? I have only one multiplied by t and zero by x in this objective function. And this very special constraint, yes. Okay, okay. So I will try to continue. Hopefully that you will get used to it in the future. Okay, let's continue. And the related problem in the lecture was linear matrix approximation. Assume that I have some desired matrix A naught, and I have some physical system of, I don't know, resistors and motors and whatever. And they have the, some free parameters. And the system which I design is expressed as sum of my design variables by some given matrices, AI. So I want to get as close as possible to my desired system, to my desired matrix. And difference between desired and real, I want to measure in operator, second operator norm, in operator two norm, which is written here. So I want to minimize two norm of this residual. It's not written here.
It says maximize, yes.
No, I want to minimize two norm of A. Here is written norm of A. It's without index two, but it is the same as was in our beginning exercise. And you recognize it, except of this is corresponds to maximal singular value. That very important, unfortunately, we don't have time to touch this topic, but it's very important. And if you can read about singular value decomposition, every engineer and scientist must know it. But instead of, we told that norm of A, this is lambda max, maximal eigenvalue of A transpose A, which we already proved in our first hour. So actually what we want to find such an X that that maximal eigenvalue of A transpose A would be as small as possible. This is our mission. Okay, any question about this? I should start giving bonuses for questions because they are really important here. Okay, thank you.
I just want to comment that we learn about singular SVD, singular value decomposition in the prerequisite numerical algorithms. I think it's a prerequisite.
In algorithms, yes, in computer science, yes.
Yes, in the introduction to numerical.
And I have other question. Do we have electrical engineering students here? Or they moved to their own?
Of course we have.
We do. So, and I hope that you also learned in some course singular value decomposition, did you? Okay, if not, then put V that you should. It's must for every engineer to know it. But for our development, it's enough to know that it's lambda max of A transpose A, which we already had. So, and as we told before, to minimize maximal eigenvalue of a matrix, we minimize T subject to Ti minus this matrix greater or equal zero. It's exactly what we had in the previous slide with very small variation. You see what we had before with all our motivation. of minimizing maximal eigenvalue. The only difference that here we have t and instead of t, I can write t square here if I know that t is positive. Yes, t square here and also t square here. And this is almost what I did. I could write t square here and t square here. But in order to minimize t square and minimize t, the solution which will minimize t square is the same as will minimize t if I know that t is non-negative. Then finally I get to this expression. And now interesting thing is coming. We should show that this inequality, conic inequality, this constraint, disadvantage of this constraint is that it's not linearly dependent on A. You have A transpose A, and efficient conic solvers, they really like the constraints which are linearly dependent on A. So using sure complement lemma, we want to show that this and this is the same. And this is your next classwork. And in order to have everything in front of our eyes, I hope that you see my whiteboard. I remind you, I will remove this stuff. I remind you sure complement lemma. Here's general notation of sure complement lemma. If I have this block matrix, it is positive definite if and only if this expression is positive definite. And you should discover something similar here. So this is your classwork. You can start working or ask questions if you have any.
Can you move the mouse?
Just a second, I will clear my whiteboard. Tell it again.
Move your mouse a little bit. I want to see this the inequality.
Just a second. I can, of course, but you should extend your screen maybe. Do you see now?
Yeah, I wanted to see the share screen inequality t is larger than zero.
Ah, it's not in share screen because I need two things at once. Okay, it's now a I little see. Bit challenging. So you see my PDF, yes?
Yes, thank you.
And the task is to show that this constraint is equivalent to this constraint. And you should use sure complement lemma, which is written here, and I hope you see my whiteboard as well. Do you see my whiteboard?
Yes.
Okay, very good. So you can start working. Works. Yes. So please share your screen.
Okay. So you just need to stop sharing your own screen.
Okay, just a second. Stop share. Yes, I did.
Okay, so I will show you my fast way. The fast way is because I thought, why not to print screen the exercise and the things that we use?
Okay.
Okay. I think that saved a little bit of time.
Okay. So,
okay. So we want to show that let's see what this expression is equivalent to, this problem, what equivalent to, and we will use Shor's lemma, where we substitute for P to be T squared times identity. R is identity, Q equals A.
I want other students also to participate. Yes?
Oh, yes, yes, definitely.
Okay.
And so, are there any questions?
Okay, okay. So you say you solved, you unfortunately you don't have the problem, the original problem.
Michael, I just want to say something. I think we should work with P equals to TI, not T squared I, in order to obtain the original constraint.
Okay.
Because then you see it by when you calculate it, you see.
Okay, so we again, so who is presenting? Ron, yes?
Yes,
oh,
yes.
Ron, maybe your presentation is right, but you didn't write it completely. You follow everything. Start with this matrix and go to sure complement. Maybe we need. Did you finish your exposition, or you want to add something?
Yes, yes, yes. Thank you. I will stop sharing.
Okay. And maybe Katya will try to make us order.
I don't have it yet.
Okay. So
I think maybe
feel free
better than the tone will
assume. Or is anybody else?
But okay. Yeah.
How long it will take, Katya? If do you have it written or not yet?
I have it. Just it would take 2 minutes, maybe. So let's see whatever you prefer.
Okay. You should wait. You should wait for 2 minutes. I will Alt P. Yes, I am recording. Who else is recording? Okay.
Michael, I'm recording, but I forgot.
But it's okay. Just continue with your share. Continue with your share, and we will manage. I see many people recording, and I hope that my recording will be okay, and no backups will be needed. Okay.
Anyway, about you say it doesn't matter too much. T squared T here. It's,
okay. So it was
confused.
Can you
just a bit confused if the in the original mean.
But pay attention. That objective function is not important for you now. You should only show equivalence of constraints. Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
I just wanted for myself to just to.
I will say you. It's important to have T in the objective function if you want to have linear semi-definite programming. In linear semi-definite programming, objective function and constraints should linearly depend on our variables. That's why T is better than T squared. Otherwise, it's equivalent.
Okay. But in the constraint, it will be T squared.
No. In the second constraint, it's only T. You remove the square, yes? Just put your pointer on the constraint. It was without square.
Ah, okay. So, wow, it's... I think
can you put your pointer in order to see on the last inequality? Do you have pointer? Can you have?
Don't you see? You don't see this.
I see. No. Really, in the bottom.
Maybe I can open it.
Maybe do you have PDF? Can you change pointer?
Just a second.
But if don't, we can see it. Not very brightly, but we can. Okay.
Just a moment. Anyway.
No. You can stay with this pointer. It's okay. Okay. So yes, with this, if you move it left where you were 1 second ago, and you have this inequality TTI, no, in the bottom, TI A transpose X, AX, no, on the left, on the left of this, yes, this one.
Okay.
You should have T without square here.
Mm-hmm. But here, I minimize over T squared.
You should not think about objective function. Let's think about constraint. We will discuss objective functions there. You should have T only linear. So you should have TI. Okay?
Yeah.
Okay, so, and go ahead.
I understand. Okay, so, because we want to solve a semi-definite programming problem, we want here to be not T squared, but T to obtain the original form of the problem. So okay. Here we should have T.
Okay.
Because it doesn't matter if we minimize over T squared or T.
When you have this constraint, T greater.
Anyway, it should be T here, yes.
Yes. But in the constraint, you have T squared. In the constraint where you are, you have T squared. Yeah. And in the bottom constraint, you have T. Okay, just show us the bottom constraint is equivalent to the to this where you are staying now. With
yes. You. Okay. So by Schur complement lemma, we know that as long as R is positive definite, so this matrix, this block matrix A would be positive definite. Yes, matrix of such form, mm-hmm. symmetric, would be positive definite if and only if the first block P minus Q transpose R minus 1 Q mm-hmm. is positive definite.
Okay.
Since we require that T is positive here in our problem,
mm-hmm.
so we know that the matrix TI is positive definite,
mm-hmm.
a scalar matrix with the positive entries on diagonal.
Mm-hmm.
Hence, the following matrix,
mm-hmm.
which is TI on the diagonal blocks and AX, A transpose X
mm-hmm.
here, is positive definite if and only if the P block which corresponds to TI
mm-hmm.
minus Q transpose, which is A transpose X,
mm-hmm.
R minus 1. Since R is TI, R minus 1 is 1 over TI, since mm-hmm. it's scalar diagonal matrix. So this is R minus 1.
Mm-hmm.
Q is AX.
Mm-hmm.
We require this to be positive definite. So this is positive definite if and only if this one is positive definite, according to the lemma.
Mm-hmm.
But we see that this is requiring that this is positive definite
mm-hmm.
is the same as multiplying it by T since T is positive.
Mm-hmm.
And as requiring that this is positive definite, the original constraint T squared I minus A transpose A.
Mm-hmm.
So actually we obtained the equivalence. We obtained that by requiring that the original constraint is positive definite or positive semi-definite. So it's the same as requiring as this is, this matrix, this block matrix is positive definite.
Okay, thank you very much. Yes.
It's a bit of balagan, but...
But it's at least it's organized. You see here the original statement and the final statement together. Yeah, thank you very much, Katya. Okay, and like I told you, there is a recording from last year, and I strongly encourage you. It goes along those lines that we did now, but it has a little bit more, and I strongly encourage you to watch it at home. So, and I think we finished 2 minutes before our official course time is finished. So, and this is the end of our course. And thank you very much for the participation.
Nehar, I just want to thank you for all your amazing patience. It was really, really wonderful. And I learned a lot about optimization and about other skills, soft skills, here in this course. So thank you very much. It was really, really a pleasure to take this course with you.
Thank you very much. But pay attention that you should not thank personally before the exams.
Yeah,
like you know, even when students submit thesis in the Technion and in other universities, they don't put thanks to anybody, especially who is participation in examination commission, before they get the mark. And after that, they're free. But thank you, Enik.
Okay. I will take that.
We may be angry. We may be angry later, but now we are thankful.
And we can discuss a little bit about exams.
We are going to this point. Again, just to make sure, you prefer to formalize this semi-definite problem with minimum over t. The objective function is t.
Thank you very much for staying still in mathematical part. I really appreciate it. Yes, the objective should be t for a very simple reason. We very often want to use linear semi-definite programming because it has really strong solvers and all other properties with proved complexity results and so on. That's why it's preferable to have T in final formulation.
Okay, but so final formulation should be T, but we also, except for requiring that this matrix is positive definite, yes, we made this transition to the linear form.
Yes, we will ask solver to use this to solve this last linear form. I'm sure, unfortunately, we don't have in front of our eyes. The last form is linear. It's larger matrix, but every element in this matrix linearly depends on x and on t together joint.
So, but when, for example, when we put this problem in a solver, it's in the form of semi-definite problem. We put this constraint in the linear constraint we obtained.
Yes.
From the
linear form, in the last form, yes.
But, and we also put t is greater than zero.
You can put it, but in the lecture, I think I have this discussion that actually it may be satisfied automatically. Because if you require this matrix, including diagonal term, to be positive definite, you will automatically have this constraint satisfied. So you don't have, actually, it helped us in the development, but in the end, you will not have to put this constraint in addition.
Because maybe this matrix can be positive definite also for negative t's, if the A is compensating for it. I'm not sure, like, I didn't think about it.
Let me think about this and leave it for future discussion. Whether T must to be as one of constraints in this problem. It was as this constraint in the lecture, yes? In the final form.
I'm not sure, actually.
Okay, let leave it for offline discussion, okay?
Okay.
Okay, and now, Kleta, I will start recording regarding the exam. I am from old school. I am from old school. I learned in Moscow. There was a strong stress on theoretical part, not only on problem solving. And as you see, I have a list of several tens of questions on my homepage, and you get the parts of it every week with the video you watch. And I strongly encourage you to know those questions, really to know. This is intensive work, I know it. To know all those questions and all the problems we solved in the class.
Just a second. All of the questions? Michal, all of the questions?
Yes, I strongly encourage you to know the answers to all the questions in the list. And I, by intent, I send you them in portions to encourage you to learn them. It's very important because after you know answers to all those questions, and the exam will be with closed material. So you have to know to reproduce answer to every of those questions and to reproduce everything we did in the class during the semester, all the problems we solved in the class. This is on my side and on the side of teaching assistants. I guess they will say that you have a list of many problems from previous years and you should be able to also to solve them. This is very important for exam preparation. And all ideas about how to make it reliable on Zoom and all critics, I encourage you to open discussion even in our Google group. Pros and cons of Zoom exams and how to do it in the best way. So the only thing that I thought, which is not currently used now, to make the questions by portions of, say, 40 minutes, and we close and you submit one question. And this, by the way, it makes even more reliable. If, for example, some technical breaks, at least part of exam you can show that you solved. So then we close. It's only as proposal, it's no obligation. Don't take it as an obligation on my side, but it's a possible proposal. And then you even have break to have tea or coffee for 10 minutes, and then we open next time, the next part, and have several parts in the exam. I feel it will be better for everybody.
Yes. I'll just comment that I think that there will be an option for several students who doesn't want to do an exam from home to get a room in the Technion to do the exam and then film it over there and
to do an exam in a group with a teaching assistant. Yes, you say this?
I'm familiar with
the control of teaching assistant. You are in student committee which discuss all these options, I understand.
Yes. So maybe students will have struggles, not enough cameras, I don't know. They can come to the Technion, they have a room, their own room, they can sit there and they solve the exam. I think that it is working under the assumption that most students will prefer to work from home, so there will not be...
Okay, and some of them who prefer from Technion maybe will have this possibility.
Yes,
Ron, it's very good you're telling this.
Okay. And let's really discuss it even on our Google group. It's very nice. Ron, you can even send this. Let's leave it for the discussion.
Unfortunately,
I have to share to finish now.
Thank you, Michael.
If you want to continue discussion even of the topic of the last lecture, Let's together try to find time even next.
Micha, just a very, very small question. In your questions there, in the questions for the exam, the theoretical questions,
yeah,
it is sometimes written, you can keep a note.
Yes, thank you. Katya, you're asking excellent questions also now. We will not permit you to bring your note, but if this question will come, we will put your note, we will give you our note with this algorithm, this description, with what was in the lecture. Okay?
So we bring nothing.
You bring nothing. You prepare nothing.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Okay. And thank you again very much for participation. It was a pleasure for me. Actually, for me, it was even more pleasant than in the class. I don't know about students. Still in the class, you feel more comfortable, possible, I can guess. Or maybe some of you feel comfortable enough with Zoom.
It was good. Micha, thank you very much.
Okay. And good luck. Good luck with exams, with our exam and with all other exams.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Goodbye.
Thank you.